Reproducible evolution. I ran into an article by the scientist. It's entitled Evolutionary Rewiring, and Strong Selective Pressure Can Lead to Rapid and Reproducible Evolution in Bacteria. And that caught my eye because I thought, we don't see too much reproducible evolution most of the time. You can find the article online. It's about a bacterium called Pseudomonas fluorescens. And in the interest of full disclosure, bacterium is in the background there. And you can find this photograph at pseudomonasfluorescens.jpg. And it's under a Wikimedia Commons license. So if you want to use it, why, you can, but you have to give them credit. Bacteria that lack a vital protein for growing flagella, tail-like structures that enable the microbes to swim, can attain flagella in as little as 4 days, given enough pressure to evolve, according to a paper published in Science Today. Furthermore, this fast fix evolves in nearly the same way in each independent strain through the repurposing of a distantly related protein. This is a fascinating set of evolution experiments, wrote evolutionary biologist Richard Lenski of Michigan State University in an email to the scientists. Their experiments showed how a biological function, in this case flagellar motility in Pseudomonas fluorescens, can re-evolve after the deletion of a seemingly critical gene. The bacteria regained motility not by reacquiring the lost gene, that's their ellipses, but instead by mutations in other genes that put their products to new uses. So we have evolution, we have reproducible evolution, and it's reproducing the function that is needed to make a flagellum, which of course is the flagship of irreducible complexity. There are still some big unanswered questions about evolution, such as how major evolutionary change takes place, said Austin Hughes of the University of South Carolina, who, like Lenski, was not involved in the work. Wait a minute. Did you read that? There are some big unanswered questions about evolution, such as how major evolutionary changes take place. That is an unanswered question. Did you catch that? They know it happens, but they have no idea how. Well, maybe they have some ideas, but nothing that really fits well enough that they can say this is the way it happens. That is, whether evolution occurs in small steps or giant leaps. That's a pretty big question to not know the answer to. Another question is whether evolution ever can be, even remotely, predictable, said study co-author Louis Johnson of the University of Reading in the UK. I thought that was settled too. We have convergent evolution, and therefore it must be predictable. Right? Interesting statements when they don't think somebody's listening. The received wisdom has always been that evolution is sort of tinkering and not necessarily finding a good path, said Johnson. So it's often thought that the direction of evolution is going to choose is going to be highly random. Well, that's kind of what I had thought was being taught, but it sounds like somebody's getting ready to challenge that. Johnson and her colleagues have now discovered, however, that not only can giant evolutionary leaps happen, but they can do so in a reproducible way. Goldschmidt is alive. Interestingly, the team didn't set out to study such profound, long-standing questions. Rather, she said, the investigations came about because PhD student and co-author Abdullah Al-Sohim made a bit of a mistake. Al-Sohim's original project had been to investigate how a lack of flagella impacts the ability of the soil bacteria P. fluorescens to colonize plant roots and help the plants grow. The bugs had been engineered to lack flea Q. That's which encodes a key transcriptional regulator for flagella genes. We'll go into that in just a little bit, exactly where that fits. But he left the plates to incubate much longer than intended, and the bacteria began to swim again. We were startled. There was another shock to come. Each bacterial strain that regained its swimming ability, first slow, then fast, did so via essentially the same evolutionary process. Well, essentially the same, kind of fudging it a little bit. It's not exactly, but okay. The team sequenced the genomes of different slow and fast swimming strains and discovered that all of the slow swimmers had mutations in genes that would directly or indirectly increase expression of a nitrogen regulatory protein called nitric C. Probably nitrogen C, but however they pronounce it. Furthermore, all the fast swimmers had mutations in the gene for nitrogen C itself. Nitrogen C shares 30% amino acid identity with flea Q. I want you to keep that in mind, suggesting that the proteins may be able to minimally cross-react with each other's target genes. Sure enough, the researchers determined that the initial mutations, which ramped up nitrogen C levels, enabled a minor upregulation of flea Q's target genes. The second mutation to nitrogen C itself then improved the protein's interaction with the flea Q targets, boosting their expression and the bacteria's ability to swim. The results highlight the importance of gene duplication in evolution, said Hughes, and the ability of the resulting diverged proteins to moonlight in roles aside from their main function. Indeed, said Jeff Barrick of the University of Texas in Austin, who is not involved in the work, such crosstalk gives organisms greater robustness, allowing them to restore a function even though they are missing a genetic part. But while the re-evolved flagella enabled the bacteria to access fluid supplies at the farthest reaches of the petri dish, the ability came at a price. The bacteria that became much better at swimming were much worse at nitrogen regulation, said Johnson. However, she added, sometimes the advantage can be so great that it's worth paying the cost because otherwise you die. This sounds interesting. First, the evolution to a specified endpoint can work at all in the laboratory is interesting. Secondly, evolution is usually thought of as random. To have obviously channelized evolution is interesting. And this particular change happens to restore the flagellum, seeming to undercut the prime example of irreducible complexity. So what's going on? Well, let's turn to the paper itself. Evolutionary resurrection of flagellar motility via rewiring of the nitrogen regulation system in Science. Oh, and I forgot to put the date. It's 2014. But while you can't get the Science article itself, what you can do is get the people who wrote it, their, if you want to call it preprint, which isn't nearly as nice as a Science article, but does have all the information you want. It's in PDF form, but it's in block PDF form, which means you can't copy it as well. If you're in the university, you can actually get it from Science Magazine itself, which is much easier to excerpt from. The Science article comes with a one-paragraph blurb that looks like it's taken from elsewhere, and that goes losing and then regaining flagella. The ability to adapt to changes in the functions of gene regulators as opposed to structural genes is a crucial aspect of evolutionary change. Taylor et al. Mutated a central regulator for the formation of flagella in the bacterium Pseudomonas fluorescens. And if you're going, they didn't mutate a piece of the flagellum itself, they just mutated the regulator. Which is enough to keep the bacterium from making flagella, but that's a different question. They then put the mutated flagella-free bacteria under strong selection pressure to regain mobility. Well, actually, they accidentally put them under pressure, and they did regain mobility. The mutated bacteria regained the lost flagella and motility within 4 days. Two stereotypical mutations diverted an evolutionarily related regulator that normally controls nitrogen uptake to control flagella biosynthesis. The mutations increased the level of the co-opted regulator, then altered its specificity for the flagella pathway. And that references to elsewhere in science. Here's the abstract of the article itself. A central process in evolution is the recruitment of genes to regulatory networks. We engineered immotile strains of the bacterium Pseudomonas fluorescens that lacked flagella due to deletion of the regulatory gene FLQ. Under strong selection for motility, these bacteria consistently regained flagella within 96 hours via a two-step evolutionary pathway. Step 1 mutations increase intracellular levels of phosphorylated nitrogen C, a distant homolog of FLQ, which begins to commandeer control of the FLQ regulation at the cost of disrupting nitrogen uptake and assimilation. Step 2 is a switch of function mutation that redirects nitrogen C away from nitrogen uptake and towards its novel function as a flagellar regulator. Our results demonstrate that natural selection can rapidly rewire regulatory networks in very few repeatable mutational steps. Very few repeatable. Okay, well, that now it's starting to come together a little bit. This is only a two-step procedure, and both steps are advantageous. Keep that in mind. A long-standing evolutionary question concerns how the duplication and recruitment of genes to regulatory networks facilitate their expansion, and how networks gain mutational robustness and evolvability. Bacteria respond to diverse environments using a vast range of specialized regulatory pathways, predominantly two-component systems, which are the result of adaptive radiation within gene families. Now, these are the regulatory pathways, and so what's happening is this is telling the bacterium when to produce a protein or a series of protein rather than actually producing the protein itself. I'm going to skip over a little bit. Here we monitor the recovery of microbial populations from a catastrophic gene deletion, which they did. Bacteria engineered to lack a particular function are exposed to environments that impose strong selection to re-evolve it, sometimes by recruitment of genes to regulatory network. In the plant-associated soil bacterium Pseudomonas fluorescens, the master regulator of flagellar synthesis is FLQ, also called ADN A. I suppose it depends on who's doing the investigating, how they name it. A sigma 54-dependent enhancer-binding protein that activates transcription of genes required for flagellum biosynthesis. The idea is if you need a flagellum, this protein will then bind to a particular area that's in front of all of the flagellar protein. We're going to see that in a minute a little bit better. All of the flagellar protein genes, and basically turns on the transcribing mechanism. So this isn't actually the flagellum itself. The flagellum is all there. They just have taken out the regulator that turns it on. The starting fluorescent strain is AR2. This strain lacks flagella due to deletion of FLQ and is unable to move by spreading motility due to mutation of viscosin synthetase, resulting in a distinctive point-like colony morphology on spreading motility medium. In other words, normally it would spread in two different ways. One of them is by flagella, and the other one is by being able to diffuse using this VISC-B. And so it actually has two mutations that have wiped out its ability to move even a little tiny bit. And so when you plate it out, as you can see, you get a little tiny point on the auger. Then one mutation will allow it to spread fairly well, and the other mutation will allow it to spread as far as it wants to. And the bacteria originally don't have anything. Then they have this kind of fuzz over here, but it isn't actually a flagellum. And finally, they have a full-blown flagellum, or maybe two. I'm not clear on whether that's a second flagellum or not. But they can make flagella, and they can actually move over the plate. Now, the cost of that is that while normally the bacterium does very well if it only has ammonia as its nitrogen source, and not quite so well with glutamine and glutamic acid, and not quite as well as with glutamine, and does okay with really fancy stuff that has everything you could possibly want, all the amino acids in the tray. The new ones actually, they grow better in the rich environment, but when it comes to ammonia, they don't do so well at all. They can't use ammonia in quite the way they used to, and that's because that when the replacement happens to normally turn on glutamine synthetase, which takes ammonia and pops it onto glutamic acid. We grew replica populations of AR2 on SMM. When local nutrients became depleted, starvation imposed strong selection to re-evolve motility. Bacteria grew, they used up all their food supply, and then they just sat there and either vegetated or died. To demonstrate that this finding was not strain-specific, we replicated these experiments in a different strain of P. fluorescens, PF0-2X. This strain is a delta flea Q variant of PF01, already viscosin deficient, so basically the same two sets of mutations were there, and thus unable to move by spreading or swimming motility. So they could use their own, they could use somebody else's, didn't matter. After 96 hours of incubation of AR2 and PF0-2X at room temperature on the medium, two breakout mutations were visible, conferring first slow, AR2S for slow, and PF0-2XS, and then fast, the F and F strains, respectively, spreading out over the agar surface, in figure 1A, which you just saw. The AR2F strain produces flagella, but we could not detect flagella in electron microscopy samples for AR2S, which you saw also. Genome resequencing revealed a single nucleotide point mutation in nitrogen B in strain AR2S, causing a, now that's not nitrogen C, that's nitrogen B, which phosphorylates nitrogen C, causing an amino acid substitution within the PAS domain of the histidine kinase sensor nitrogen B, that is three, at position 97, threonine goes to proline. The fast spreading strain of AR2F had acquired an additional point mutation in the sigma 54 dependent EPB gene nitrogen C, which alters an amino acid, that is 442, and I've forgotten what R and C is, I should know, within the DNA binding domain. And they have table 1 and table S2. And let's see if I have, I have table 1 in just a bit. Nitrogen B and nitrogen C make up a two-component system. Under nitrogen limitation, where you don't have enough nitrogen to make your amino acids that you want, or for that matter, your purine bases and pyrimidine bases, nitrogen B phosphorylates nitrogen C, which activates transcriptions of genes required for nitrogen uptake and metabolism, specifically glutamine synthetase. To determine how mutations in this separate regulatory pathway restored motility in the absence of LeQ, we performed microarray and quantitative reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction analysis of the ancestral and evolved strains. Basically, they're analyzing the DNA there. Figures S1 and table S1. The expression of, that's the supplementary stuff, the expression of genes required for flagellum biosynthesis and chemotaxis was abolished in AR2 compared with wild type SBW25. And here's our figure 2. And this is interesting because you can see that the bacterial flagellum stuff is normal. On the red end is higher activity. And then when you compare it with the delta FleQ, or you have their own strain, both of them you can see produce very little in the way of flagellar motor proteins. With the one, you have partial recovery, and with the other one, you have actually more than complete recovery. They produce more flagellar proteins than you would expect. Now, this is a little weird, and you can look at it and decide what you want to do with it, because I'm having trouble meshing this with what they say. This looks like relatively normal nitrogen compound transport, which is what you'd expect. This looks like decreased nitrogen transport, and this looks like increased nitrogen transport, but if you read the article, it sounds like they're talking about the reverse, that that you have decreased nitrogen transport, and you figure that out. The nitrogen B mutation in AR2S partially restores the expression of flagellar genes and overactivates the expressions of genes involved in nitrogen regulation. Okay, that much fits with the photo. Uptake and metabolism. So there's more than just the glutamate synthetase. There's a whole raft of genes that are increased. The subsequent nitrogen C mutation in AR2F reduces the expression of nitrogen uptake, although sure looked like it was increasing it in the, let's go back and look at that in a minute here, and metabolism genes while further upregulating flagellar and chemotaxis gene expressions to wild type levels. Actually, to be precise, it looks like it's upgrading them to more than wild-type levels. This is close to wild-type. Maybe this is dropped compared with this, but it certainly looks like it's increased compared with this. So your mileage may vary on this. Although AR2S and AR2F showed higher growth rates than the ancestor in lysogeny broth, that's the super broth that has everything you want, that's the medium on which the mutants arose. Both mutants grew poorly in minimal medium with ammonium as the sole nitrogen source because they couldn't regulate that, I guess. This is likely to be the result of ammonium toxicity due to the strong upregulation of genes involved in ammonia intake and assimilation, indicating a pleiotropic cost for this adaptation. Now, I'm not sure whether they've got that right or not, but certainly you can say that there appears to be a cost to the upregulation of flagellar protein in terms of nitrogen, in terms of growth in ammonium medium, which is actually closer to what the organisms are going to find in the wild. Sequencing of the nitrogen BC locus from independently evolved replicant strains showed that evolution often followed parallel trajectories in both AR2 and PF0-2X. Mutation of nitrogen B gave a slow-spreading strain, and this was followed by mutation of nitrogen C, yielding a fast-spreading strain. Although all PF02FXF replicates carried mutations in nitrogen C, several PF02XS strains were not mutated in nitrogen B, suggesting an alternative evolutionary pathway. That is to say, some of them could mutate a different protein that had the same general effect. Genome resequencing of these strains revealed mutations in GLNA or GLNK that are likely to result in loss of function, leading to abnormally high levels of phosphorylated nitrogen C. Reduced ammonium assimilation by glutamine synthetase, that's GLNA, would impose severe nitrogen limitation in the cell irrespective of nitrogen availability, whereas GLNK is a P2 protein that regulates both nitrogen B and glutamine synthetase activities. So it turns out that it's even more complex than you think. That is to say, GLNK regulates nitrogen B, which in turn regulates nitrogen C, which now regulates GLNA. Now, here's some of the mutations that they had, and you will notice that here's the T97P that they talked about earlier, but there you can also mutate position 185 from valine to, I think that's arginine, and then you can mutate another place here, 179, or you can mutate 184. And it looks like two mutations at once. And you'll notice that you can have four different mutations here that will change it from a slow spreader to a fast spreader. Now, in P102X, there is one mutation that can give rise to five different mutations of nitrogen C, or another mutation here, and then here's those oddballs that are not nitrogen B at all. They're GLNK or GLNA. And again, you have a two-step process in every single one of these, both steps of which are advantageous. But there isn't a lot of duplication here. This is not really reproducible evolution in the traditional sense, where the same mutation happens in for every time that you go through this. You have at least four different, completely different pathways for AR2, and you have five completely different pathways for P102X, two of which have several branches at the end. And if you look at these, at least a cursory look at it didn't show that there were identical mutations in any of them. Interestingly, if you do a frame shift at 342, you can kind of wipe out a whole part of the nitrogen C and get it to turn on flagella regardless of whether it should normally or not. Now, in this figure, I want to bring your attention to, this is nitrogen C and this is FLE-Q, and you will notice that structurally they're very very similar, even though they only have 30% of the same amino acids. That you have a bunch up here, you have another bunch down here that matches, and this is kind of similar, although not exactly. These data suggest a predictable two-step evolutionary process. Step one increases levels of phosphorylated nitrogen C via either a direct regulatory route with mutations in nitrogen B or GLNK, or a physiologic route with loss of function mutations reducing glutamine synthetase activity and causing nitrogen B activation because of leftover or lacking metabolic products. Partially or intermittently reactivating the flagellar cascade. In step two, nitrogen C adapts to enhance activation of the flagellar genes, and in doing so becomes a less potent activator of nitrogen uptake genes. All of those are two-point mutations, or in one case, one point and one frame shift. This model explains the microarray data and is consistent with the predicted structural effects of the mutations. Specifically for nitrogen B, the structural changes are likely to either increase kinase or reduce phosphatase activity, in any case leaving more phosphates on nitrogen C than you would normally expect. In support of this, the mutated nitrogen B, at least one of them, repeatedly emerging in PFO2SX resembles nitrogen B D227 to A in Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This is probably the same exact point, except that Pseudomonas has one extra amino acid on it, which constitutively activates the nitrogen system. Nitrogen C is a distant homolog of FLEQ, sharing 30% amino acid identity in the same three structural domains, which we saw. An N-terminal receiver domain, a conserved central sigma 54 interacting domain. It happens to interact with, I'm blanking on the particular protein now. And a C-terminal DNA binding domain containing a helix-turn-helix motif flanked by highly disordered regions. We posit that an overabundance of phosphorylated nitrogen C activates transcription of flagellar genes through functional promiscuity. Basically, it performs actions that it would not normally. Consistent with this, the nitrogen C mutations in fast-spreading strains are predominantly located within or adjacent to the HTH domain and probably influence enhancer binding specificity. One is a frame shift, abolishing the HTH altogether. The evolved nitrogen C prime must be constitutively phosphorylated by overactive nitrogen B to enable its new multipurpose role, with the result that flagellum biosynthesis and nitrogen regulation are probably no longer responsive to environmental stimulation. They're always on. Consequently, there's a trade-off between nitrogen use and motility. The flagellar regulatory network may have an unusually dynamic evolutionary history. Flagellar are expensive to make and not always advantageous. Pathogens expressing flagella can trigger strong immune responses in the host. This is one of the disadvantages. You can make antibodies against the flagella easier than you can the rest of the bacteria. So rapid transitions are seen over short timescales between uniflagellate, that's one, multiflagellate, which Pseudomonas fluorescence actually is, normally, and aflagellate states. This volatility is reflected in the structure of regulatory networks. In close relatives of Pseudomonas, FLEQ appears not to be involved in flagellar gene expression, and in Helicobacter pylori, which lives in your stomach if you're unfortunate, a gene of unknown function can be used as a spare part to permit mobility in FLHB mutants. Our results illustrated that transacting mutations can contribute to gene network evolution, but that as predicted, such mutations bear severe pleiotropic costs. Genes can retain the potential to take on the functions of long divergent homologs, suggesting that some degree of evolutionary resilience is a consequence of regulatory pathways that evolve via gene duplication. I want you to think about a little bit about long diverged homologs. How do they know that they're long diverged? Interesting question. Although de novo origination of new functions in nature is likely to take longer and involve more mutational shapes, this system enables us to understand the adaptive process in detail at the genetic and phenotypic level. We identified a tractable model for gene network evolution. They can actually get it to change and to supply something that isn't there, wasn't there before, and observed in real time the rewiring of gene networks to enable the incorporation of a modified component, that is nitrogen C prime, creating a novel regulatory function. Well, actually not regulatory if you think about it. If it's always on, it's not regulating anymore. By a highly repeatable two-step evolutionary pathway with the same point mutations occurring in independent lineages. Wait a minute. Did you see that up there? At least on the table, it shows that most of them are independent. Now maybe what they're saying is that the same mutations happened a few times and they just didn't put it into the table. Maybe that's what they're talking about. Now, my take is that this experiment is largely reported accurately. I still don't know what to do with decreases in function in the text that seem to be increases in the function in that figure too. The table seems to belie the claim that the changes in nitrogen C are reproducible, although maybe that's because they simply didn't say it arose three different times or something like that. If I understand the process, it goes something like this. I put the reference so that you can look it up. But here's the flagellum in general, and you can see there's all kinds of different parts to it. FLIB, FLIC, FLI. There's actually an FLIQ, so you have to watch out. Okay. FLEQ is different. Okay. So there's all these proteins that have to be put together in the right way. And again, I'll show you the reference so that you can see it. This one is again one of those open access, but you have to say what. Here is some of the regulatory proteins, and we're going to concentrate on Pseudomonas species, which will include Pseudomonas aeruginosa and also Pseudomonas fluorescens. And here's FLEQ, which turns on the whole thing with something called RPON, which is that sigma 54 that you've seen before. And that starts the ball rolling, and then it also produces FLE-S and FLE-R. And with RPON, that FLE-S and FLE-R initiates the next stage of building, which is the rod, the ring, the hook, and the hook cap. And then finally, when you get FLIA, and I'm not sure which stage that's in, I would presume it's in this area, then it turns on to FLIC, FLII, FLIM, FLIN, and some chemotaxis proteins so they can know when to go what way. So FLEQ is what was taken out. All the rest of the flagellum was there. And they were able to replace it with another protein. Well, sort of replace it. So what happens is in a normal type, you have FLEQ, which normally binds appropriately and stimulates the transcription of a DNA beyond it. Then you have, I should have labeled these, then you have nitrogen C, which binds to another area, in a completely different area of DNA, and stimulates transcription of various other proteins as well. If you take this out, of course, you don't have any flagella. If you phosphorylate this using an abnormal nitrogen B, then you phosphorylate this, and it happens to move over some of the time to the site that would normally start flagella. While it doesn't fit as well here, now I don't know whether it doesn't fit in as well or it fits in too well, but in some way it does not go as well, as physiologically at least, in its normal spot. And then finally, for the fast motile, this mutates a little further so it fits even better into the old flea Q binding site. And again, it does not regulate its normal site as well, although I suspect that these really should be bound even tighter. But in any case, that's what you're looking at. Now, we've actually seen this before. E. coli has had its LacZ enzyme deleted and recruited another gene, this time a hexacidase, dubbed EBG, with one mutation. The operon for the hexacidase gene then also required a mutation to get it turned on. So it's a two-step process, and again, each step being more advantageous than the step before. When one mutation is all that is needed, evolution can be rapid. And if two consecutive mutations are all that's needed, but each one has an advantage, evolution can be quite rapid. When two mutations are required for a new function, progress is much slower. And although it can happen with bacteria, and this is one of the demonstrations, Chlorican is one of the demonstrations, then it's really out of reach for large mammals. That's things like elephants and people. With four mutations needed, progress is much slower and requires massive fitness gradients on the order of 10 to the 17th, excuse me, in viruses. We had a video on that not that long ago where it's evolution works, ! A demonstration. The major surprise and advance from their point of view in this particular case was that it took only two mutations to mostly recreate the function of flea Q, and that one mutation gave some benefit. This came at a cost in nitrogen metabolism, although perhaps if we reproduced the nitrogen gene to begin with, we could have two nitrogen regulators, and one of them could have turned into regulating the flagellum. And that would be the standard way of looking at this. The problem is this cannot be extended forever. For example, if one deletes both the LacZ gene and the EBG gene from E. coli, the bacterium does not recover lactase function during years of experimentation. Decades, centuries, who knows? We haven't done it long enough to be able to say, but it, whatever it is, it does not. In other words, you have two genes that can, one gene that's designed for it, apparently, one gene that kind of can fit, and then after that, you're out of luck. For practical purposes, six neutral or two deleterious mutations are about as far as bacteria can traverse. Now the question is, does the adaptive landscape have pathways to every single enzyme that require only up to six neutral or two deleterious mutations for bacteria, or more importantly, no deleterious mutations for large mammals? Every single mutation has to be advantageous in some circumstance, otherwise you can't select for it. Experimentally, the answer would appear to be no. This is the work of Axe and Gager. The flagellar experiment is interesting, but I don't think it's a game changer. I think you have to be very careful about accepting hype. I think critical thinking on these subjects is still valuable. If you get somebody that says, oh, we've now proved evolution, look at the details. They may not have. Now, one last point I think that's important. Flea Q and nitrogen C have 30% homology. Now, 5% homology is theoretically random. That is, if you just, you know, amino acids and flip the coin or whatever your random way of doing things is, and you just put them side by side, you would get 5% homology. Now, in practice, it's probably not that. It's probably more like 10% because there's more alanine than there is tryptophan in most proteins. So it's not really 1 in 10 to the 20th. And besides that, if you're allowed to shift the two sequences a little bit, you can probably get a better fit. And so 10% is probably random, really. Which means that 20% of 470 amino acids, which happens to be the size of a nitrogen C, is 94 amino acids. That is, these two have about 94 amino acids in common. Now, I want you to notice that 20 to the 94th is 10 to the 122nd. That is, this is not likely to happen by chance. And so they will use the argument up front that this improbability of having 30% the same amino acids means it must have had a common ancestor, because otherwise it would have developed randomly. Right? That's the argument being made. A much higher improbability, however, does not prove directed origin. That is, if you have to make a complete protein, if you have to make 20 proteins, if you have to make 40 proteins, the smallest organism that I know of that can reasonably be considered living is about 400 proteins, and maybe you can shave that down to 250 if you're really, really careful, but that's a lot of proteins. And yet somehow that high, very high improbability does not prove in a directed origin. Why is that? It's because common ancestry is believable. Design is, in fact, not believable. I think you can call this bias at its finest. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Go ahead.
Oh, I'll read the question. I agree. This is not a game changer at all. It doesn't solve the design issue. I mean, and you mentioned in mammals especially and so on, but still, I was surprised that they got the results so fast there in 4 days. Bacteria reproduce once an hour or something like this. But apparently this is a hot spot or something and they repeated it several times apparently in different strains.
That's right.
What I am surprised about is this 30% homology functioning.
Well, you think about it. They're both doing the same job. They're both, if I can put it that way, designed to hug the DNA at a certain specific spot that has a certain specific sequence so that they can turn on the genes behind it. And the DNA that they hug is very similar except for the base sequence.
I suppose, you know, when you talk about 10,000 genes. I don't know how many genes there are in a bacterium, but maybe. Why don't they get mixed up more in they select functions?
It's pretty amazing how specific the protein shape has to be in order to pick out not just that it's DNA, but that it's DNA with, you know, AAT instead of GGC or something.
But here they're replacing a function with 30% homology.
But you see, it's already the shape of the back of the enzyme is virtually the same, you know, except for a few little tweaks inside. So it doesn't surprise me that you can actually change something that's only 30% the same, because it's really functionally it's more like 98% the same.
I'm wondering, does redundancy negate design? In other words, when technicians design those vehicles that go into space, they have redundancy. Just in case something fails, something else will take over. So does redundancy negate design?
No, actually, redundancy is something that is difficult to see how you can run into by just randomness. There is no point in selecting for a spare tire, except in very rare instances. And if those don't happen often enough, there's not enough selective pressure to have a spare tire. Which is why a lot of people drive around without spare tires, because there's not enough selective pressure.
Do you see redundancy in this experiment?
In some ways, yes. And in some ways, the LAC-Z EBG system also has redundancy in it. So, yeah, I think we're designed, and I think the bacteria were designed to take a lot of hits before they go down. But, see, that's if you start with design. If you start with, well, no, it had to be cobbled together, then you just say, well, they cobbled together some extra stuff, and this one evolved to bind to this part of DNA, this one evolved to bind to this part of DNA, and... when you take out this one, well, the other one actually will evolve back to do the function of the first one. It's not really the function of the first one, to be perfectly fair. The new one is always on, whereas the old one knew when to turn off. But it's still better than nothing. My point is not so much to come and tell you that because of this you should be a creationist or even an intelligent design advocate. What I do want to say is this, that when you look at this, you should not be terrified, okay? There are giants in the land, and we look like grasshoppers. Don't take that mentality, because it's not true.
Has there been, have you heard of any case where, you know, this flagellum has been an icon for creation in a ways and a target for evolutionists?
Oh, yes. This is the first one I've seen where they actually showed that you could replace the function of one protein with a different one.
Yeah, but what I'm just wondering is, are journalists or anybody saying, well, hey, you can evolve the flagellum in 4 days? That's probably stretching it a bit.
Well, to be fair, the science article knows that they got scientists looking over their shoulders and knows that if you made that kind of a claim, you'd be laughed out of court. The scientist article, the secondary article, kind of makes hints and kind of broad brushes it a little bit, but is still pretty careful because I guess they have scientists reading that. And so, no. What will be interesting to see is what happens to it when it hits the popular press and people lose those kind of fine distinctions. Because I suspect that this could be painted as, we can now evolve a complete protein. You didn't evolve a complete protein. You made two little changes.
I'm venturing into very shaky territory here because I don't know anything. I don't know what you're talking about. But anyway, it was interesting to me at the beginning when they're describing this study, they're using words like selective pressure and repurposing. Those are not evolutionary terms. I mean, that's random, purposeless evolution, I thought.
Well, remember that natural selection is a design substitute.
Is it design?
It's a design substitute.
Yes. But it's interesting that they use that kind of words right away in setting up the study, that the whole thing was rigged from the beginning.
Well, it wasn't deliberately rigged, but I agree with you that that from the bacteria's point of view, it was rigged. Yeah.
Here's the lay lady. But bacteria do change.
They do?
I mean, they become resistant to antibiotics. They become, the malaria situation changes. Things change. What's the difference between evolution and change?
This is the beauty of using the word evolution if you're an evolutionary biologist, is that it can mean anything from one or two mutations to going from non-living matter to humans. It's all the same process.
or from responding to an antibiotic to resisting an antibiotic. Is that evolution in the bacteria?
The question is, how far can evolution go? And that's a legitimate question, and there's a very simple reason why I can tell you for sure that there is a limit. And the way I can tell you for sure is that if you plate bacteria in a petri dish and you come back the next morning and you see a cockroach in the dish, you do not usually... Your first hypothesis is not that the cockroach evolved from bacteria overnight.
Jumped in there.
Do you want to say something? Let me get to you in a... we'll get you your comments on where we can hear them.
I have a layman's contribution. Is regeneration considered evolution?
That's the beauty of evolution, is it that any movement is evolution, and the whole thing is evolution, and so if you can prove any movement, then you can prove the whole thing. You know, Darwin did this in The Origin of Species. He talks about The Origin of Species. I happen to believe he's correct in The Origin of Species in one sense, and that is that certain things that we now call different species are, in fact, from the same ancestor. I'll give you an example. Dog, the wolf, the coyote. Of course, they can all interbreed, but that's a different, you know. They probably came from the same pair of animals on the ark, if you want to put it bluntly. Okay? Now, is that if you prove that two different species come from the same species, the same original pair, does that prove that you can go from amoeba to man? And the obvious answer is no, it doesn't prove it. But this is a sleight of hand. You're arguing that little tiny changes, if you add one and you add another and you add another and you put enough time behind them, that you can get all the way from amoeba to man and in the standard evolutionary theory, you can get all the way from the origin of life to man. And, you know, to make that jump is just, you know, it's really beyond me. But that's the jump that's being made. And I find it fascinating that they can prove that these were once the same enzyme because they have 30% of the same amino acids. And yet, you have vastly more odds against getting an original organism, and that statistic just doesn't count. Because what it boils down to is, what can you believe? I can believe that we came all the way from amoeba. I can't believe that there's a designer that set it up. And so that's the kind of reasoning that's being done here. You accept the stuff that you can believe. You don't accept the stuff that you can't believe, even if the statistics are worse for the latter.
Oh, one other aspect we need to consider here, I think, is, as mentioned, bacteria change, you know, people change also. And the broader picture that we have as we deal with these mutations here is that, you know, maybe the most generous figure you can come up with is probably one mutation out of 1,000 is beneficial. Figures go up to 1 out of 1,000,000. And so you have this cadre of changes, a tremendous proportion of which are neutral or negative. How are you going to fight against all these negative ones with just so few beneficial ones? And of course, Sanford and his genetic entropy pointed out how, you know, we're headed towards degeneration, and I think there's good evidence of that in certain areas, that it's a downhill road in terms of the available hardware here, or software, mm-hmm. whichever way you want to call it. And so that aspect also adds to this picture of maybe once in a while you get something beneficial, and of course it's hailed immediately as a great victory, and that in itself tells you how difficult it is to find these victories.
Well, did you notice at the beginning, we have no idea how this happened, we have no idea how, and you're going, now you tell us. You know, and as far as the degeneration part of it, did you notice how many different mutations there were that could get this thing to work? Can you imagine how many other mutations that there were as well that were going the other direction? This tremendous flow of gene information downhill. You know, and if you are observing a water strider going under a bridge, and the water is running 20 miles per hour downstream, and the water strider is going 2 miles an hour upstream, there are two things that you can say. Number one, he didn't get there by swimming upstream. And number two is, it's not going to take too long before he goes over the falls. So yeah, we're heading towards genetic catastrophe. It's just a matter of time. 120 new mutations in every human. Most of them deleterious. When you have your kids, there are going to be 120 mutations, more or less, maybe 60, maybe 180, depending on the person and how much you're eating. Worse off than you are. No. That's right. Your kids are not going to inherit a better world well, at least, you know, we can do some planning on some of that, but they're going to inherit a worse themselves than we are. And we're worse off than our great-great-grandparents. It's sobering to think about.
With reference to the question about can evolution be negative, one of the instructors, University of Michigan, where I did some of my graduate work, or most of it actually, plainly stated, yeah, evolution can be positive, it can be negative. Any change is evolution.
And you see, by that definition, evolution happens, and therefore you have to believe the whole ball of wax, which is just, you know, that's hard to believe.
You know, along the lines of his redundancy question, it seems that life would be so fragile without tremendous redundancy in our control mechanisms and our genetic material that I would expect design to have put in a lot of redundancy and a lot of ability to adapt in multiple areas, and that may include the genetic material in order for survivorship. Otherwise, I think life would have ended a long time ago.
Well, you think about it. In our endocrine system, okay, there's, you know, TSH that adjusts how much thyroid you're supposed to put out. You weren't just given with a certain amount of thyroid and that's it. That there's actually a feedback mechanism there. And beyond that, there's another feedback mechanism with TRH. And that's the way it is with most of our endocrine systems. There's a control, and sometimes there's a control on the control. And if it weren't for that, we'd probably, most of us, be hopelessly out of balance. And there are a few people where the control system doesn't work, and you can see what happens.
And then you face the question, how do you evolve redundancy when you've got already a system that works well? It's a tremendously difficult thing.
Why build a spare tire if you've already got four tires anyway?
You have to
think ahead and say, you know, in the desert I'm going to hit a nail.
Well,
right?
If you have a system that works, you know, that, like blood clotting, how are you going to have some redundancy in it? Why do this when the system is working there already? How are you going to get any survival value by building up a whole bunch of parts of a system that is not needed? This is a difficult situation, the redundancy, I think, in terms of evolution.
Yeah, well, it's not a slam dunk. And if you read this article, when you first read it, you might think, oh, my, that's impressive. But I think after you really go over it, it's not that impressive. What it shows is that small changes can happen. What you need is large changes. And you need them all to be positive ones, and I really have a hard time believing that the fitness landscape is that smooth with that nice little pipeline going from where you started to where you want to go. It's really hard to believe that. And they haven't challenged that, I don't think. All they've shown is that there's one little pathway of two amino acids that will actually work. And that's a point I think most creationists should have conceded a long time ago. Because, yes, you can get little tiny changes. Every once in a while, if you type a comma instead of a period, you know that was actually a good thing. But if you're going to write Shakespeare, you've got to have a whole lot more than just random changes that happen to be better each time. Well, come back next week, and we'll see what we can do with the Ordovician on Mount Everest.